Good evening, class.
Good evening.
My name is Nanette Ramirez, and I'll be your moderator for this evening's class. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to showing the proof of the existence of Yahweh our Elohim and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. Since then, we've established various branch schools throughout the United States and in various parts of the world. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of the Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It was improperly substituted by Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are Lords many and Gods many, but we now know that each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. That means Elohim is a title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part in a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any characters or letters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by the letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings of the true and original name of our Father and his Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, he is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have drawn this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being that is having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form could only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now, there is only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. The simple yet intelligent question that we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses on top of Mount Sinai and showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. Yahweh instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. The pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court roundabout. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. Our 10 primary constitutional objectives and aims of this institute are, first, to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. Second, to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third, to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth, to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth, to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth, to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh, to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth, to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith, which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth, to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. Tenth, to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. This evening, we'll have a prayer by Dr. Eunice Reiser. And our scripture lesson will be Psalms, the 85th and 86th division. And we'll have a selection of music after the prayer.
Good evening. Let's bow our hearts and mind in a moment of prayer. Gracious Father Yahweh, you allowed us once again to come here and sup. You've been feeding us very well, and I greatly appreciate that we do not hunger, but only to be fed again. We ask that you continue to strengthen us and give us and keep us in the mindset to be here to learn more about your purpose, your pattern, and your plan, because we truly know that you have given unto us salvation and eternal life, and we want to maintain and help others to know of the same opportunity. All these things and many others we ask in thy son's name, Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Sorry. Good evening. Tonight we will be reading the 85th and 86th division of Psalms, and it'll be coming from the Holy Name Bible, the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testaments, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts. It was revised by A.B. Traina. He happened to have been an Italian Jew, and he was with the Scripture Research Association Incorporated. This particular Bible was reprinted by Yahshua Promotions. Psalms, the 85th division. O Yahweh, thou hast been favorable unto thy land. Thou hast brought back the captivity of Jacob. Thou hast forgiven the iniquity of thy people. Thou hast covered all their sins, Selah. Thou hast taken away all thy wrath. Thou hast turned thyself from the fierceness of thine anger. Turn us, O Elohim of our salvation, and cause thine anger toward us to cease. Wilt thou be angry with us forever? Wilt thou draw out thine anger to all generations? Wilt thou not revive us again, that thy people may rejoice in thee? Show us thy mercy, O Yahweh, and grant us thy salvation. I will hear what Yahweh Elohim will speak, for he will speak peace unto his people and to his sons, but let them not turn again to folly. Surely his salvation is nigh them that fear him, that glory may dwell in our land. Mercy and truth are met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. Thou shalt spring out of the earth, and righteousness shall look down from heaven. Yea, Yahweh shall give that which is good, and our land shall yield her increase. Righteousness shall go before him, and he shall set us in the way of his steps. 86th. Bow down thine ear, O Yahweh. Hear me, for I am poor and needy. Preserve my soul, for I am holy. O thou my Elohim, save thy servant that trueth in me, in thee. Be merciful unto me, O Yahweh, for I cry unto thee daily. Rejoice the soul of thy servant, for unto thee, O Yahweh, do I lift up my soul. For thou, Yahweh, art good and ready to forgive, and plenteousness in mercy unto all them that call upon thee. Give ear, O Yahweh, unto my prayer, and attend to the voice of my supplication. In the day of my trouble I will call upon thee, for thou wilt answer me. Among the mighty there is no Elohim like unto thee, O Yahweh, neither are there any works like unto thy works. All nations thou hast made shall come and worship before thee, O Yahweh, and shall glorify thy name. For thou art great, and doest wondrous things. Thou art Elohim alone. Teach me thy way, O Yahweh. I will walk in thy truth. Unite my heart for fear thy name. I will praise thee, O Yahweh, my Elohim, with all my heart, and I will glorify thy name forevermore. For great is thy mercy toward me, and thou hast delivered my soul from the lowest Sheol. O Yahweh, the proud are risen against me, and the assemblies of violent men have sought after my soul, and have not set thee before them. But thou, O Yahweh, art an El full of compassion and graciousness, long-suffering and plenteousness in mercy and in truth. O turn me and have mercy upon me. Give thy strength unto thy servant, and save the son of thine handmaid. Show me a token for good, that they which hate me may see it and be ashamed, because thou, Yahweh, hast helped me and comforted me. That was Psalms 86 and 85 and 6. Let us all say hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Eunice Reiser and Dr. Bud Wench. Tonight is our Thursday night open lecture testimony night. Would anyone care to give a lecture or testimony? Anybody on Zoom?
Yes, I would.
All right, so we have Hartense. Take it away.
Today, I was watching a video, of Doc. It was called The Universal Pattern Expressed in Nature, and it was from the 11th of April, 2012. As I was listening to it, he said the first thing that back then he was using God and Jesus. So he said the first thing that Yahweh instructed man to make was the ark. And I had to rewind this tape like three times because we talk about Moses and the tabernacle pattern all the time and Yahweh having Moses to construct the tabernacle pattern. And I'm thinking, wait a minute, he's saying the ark. And all I'm thinking about is the tabernacle pattern. And then it dawned on me that Dr. Love always admonishes us that we have to learn the ages and dispensations. So when I thought about that, then I could continue on with this video. And so then I could get it together that it was the ark, because if you put it in the right dispensation, then you'll see that it was the ark. And he explained that it was threefold. It had a lower deck, a middle deck, and an upper deck. And it only had one door and one window, because there is only one God. And then again, it caught me because I noticed again that I had to try to visualize the charts. When I first came into class, I was a moose. So like Aloha, that was just everything to me. I just knew I had it right. And when I was invited to come to class and I seen the name, and I'm saying, okay, because we're always taught in class, don't take anything that is said to you on this floor. Make it be proven to your satisfaction. So I did get a dictionary and an encyclopedia, and I looked up those words. Now, being in the military, when I first went in the military, I was a chaplain's assistant, and I worked with the Catholic priest and the Episcopalian minister. And when I would set up for them for their services, I would sometimes look in their Bible. The Catholic Bible has the name Yahweh in it. So in that way, I kind of knew that what I was hearing in class, even though I was new, it was showing me that there's something that I can build on in this name. So when Doc, excuse me for saying Doc, but I'm so used to calling Dr. Kenley Doc. It's Dr. Henry Clifford Kenley that had this divine vision and divine revelation. So when he said that there was only one door and one window, because there is only one God. And then I'm thinking, I'm trying to go back to the chart to see, because when I was in the churches, I was raised Catholic. I always knew God to be the Father. But when you see the charts, then you see how the names are actually displayed on the charts. You see that it says that the Father, yeah, thank you. The Father is Yahweh or Lord, and Elohim is God. But even though I've seen that for all these years, because I came in class like in 1976, I never really paid attention. You see things. I've seen things on the chart ever since I could remember. But I didn't really see it. You just hear a teacher give a lecture and they go over the chart, but are we really paying attention to what we're seeing? And it's very important that we do, because our soul depends on it. So I'm thinking, he's saying God, and I'm trying to get this wrapped up in my mind, and I'm trying to write some things down. And I'm trying to go back to the chart to see, because I always associated God with being the Father. So as he breaks down the ark and how it's being threefold, then he goes to the next thing that Yahweh instructed Moses to build, which was the tabernacle. And the third thing was King David. And this is something I didn't know. He said that, let me see, where is it at? Because I wrote it down. Oh, he told David, the king of Israel, to see that the temple was built. He gave him the pattern of the temple by making him understand the structure of his physical body, so he would know how the structure was to impart to his son Solomon. David, being a type of the son, he could not build the sanctuary, or he could not build the temple. His son Solomon had to build it, just like Yahweh did not build, well, Elohim did not build the church. His son, Yahshua, had to build it. And all this time, I had to play this tape, this video. I had to rewind it and rewind it and rewind, because I'm trying to get this in my head, that how we might think we're paying attention to what we hear on the floor, and it's very important that you do. And I can only refer to myself, all the years I've been in class. And I know Dr. Jerry Kenley is my dean. And he used to always say that Doc said, you don't know that you don't know that you don't know. And I'm thinking that I'm learning something. And I really wasn't, because I really wasn't paying that much attention. The instructor would get on the floor, he would go over the chart, he would give you some scriptures, and after class was over, you might stay around and talk about it, but then you don't really think too much about it until the next time that you have the opportunity to come to class. And I just wanted to say that with me listening to this, watching this video today, how much I appreciate Dr. Love, when he explains things, he gives it to you in different ways to see that you get it. And when I moved back to Columbus, I grew up in the, well, I came up in the Columbus class. And when I came back to Columbus, I'm saying, okay, I can go back to class. I went to the Columbus class and I could not believe it. After class was over, I went up to David. I said, David, how did y'all get here? Because we all came up under Dr. Miller together. And it really bothered me that they had gotten so far out the game. And I called Dr. Gill and I said, Dr. Gill, do I have to go back to the Columbus class? And he said, no, Hortense. And he's the one that told me about YouTube. And then I called Jerry and I asked him, and Jerry said, well, Hortense, I think that every once in a while, you should go back to the Columbus class so you can see how Yahshua has blessed you. I haven't been back because I can't bring myself to even want to sit up under that false doctrine. And I would start looking at other classes on YouTube, and it's like they would just, the instructor would get on the floor and they go over things. They didn't really break it down to explain it to you. And I'm at the stage now where that's what I need. And that's why I really like the Ontario class, because they do go over things in several different ways so you can get it. Now, I understand that if Yahweh doesn't reveal it to you, you won't get it, but it's by the teaching and preaching continuously over and over and over again through this gospel that we have a chance. And I just wanted to share that this evening because I really appreciate the Ontario class, because it's like when I was in the Cincinnati class and my earlier years in the Columbus class. And with that, I thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Hortense. So would anyone else care to give a lecture or a testimony? Anybody on Zoom? No? Okay, so for our second speaker tonight, I'd like to call our Dean, Dr. Marlon Love.
Good evening, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here. And you got volume on me? Turn that white one. Push it up. Keep going. Keep going right there. That's good. Should be fine. Enjoy the testimony from Hortense, the previous vessel. Some of the things that she is continuing to hear. Of things that has been said. She's been around since 1976 in this teaching. And to some it seemed like a long time. But this is not a one-time course that we are teaching here. You know, it's not a one-time learning, as she expressed about Noah and the ark. And we've heard Noah and the ark story for a long time, but yet there's still things being revealed about that story. We had Psalms read, which is written by David, on the things that he saw of Elohim. And we make mention about the unity of the Spirit in this school, about Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua. And we know, as Dr. Kinney said, in 1963, because like Hartens mentioned, he spoke and taught for a number of years, Lord God and Jesus Christ, right, without a doubt. And he spoke to those people during those times about the unity of Lord God and Jesus Christ. Now, the Trinity had started during that time. You have the AB Trainer and the Scripture Research Association having started the Sacred Name Movement using Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua in 1931, right? Turn that down a little bit more. Don't want to blow you out. So then you have the name and you have the title. And Dr. Kinney used Lord God and Jesus Christ. Yeah. You have a comment, boss?
Was in the 61 book in God the Archetype Pattern. It was in there.
What was in there?
The Elohim.
In the first book, God the Archetype Pattern.
Right.
There, it's in there.
Oh, using the Lord God in Jesus Christ?
Yes, predominantly, but there is a page in there where he identifies the original name of Yahweh.
Right. And he's always known the name. He knew that name in 1931, when he had that divine vision and revelation. But he did not use that name and profusely or ongoing until he made a declaration in 1963, expressing, I think Hartens may have heard of the story that Jerry Kinney would speak about, being the grandson of Dr. Kinney, if you continue to use the name of Lord God, or the titles of Lord God and the erroneous name of Jesus Christ, you'll be lost. You follow? And he's making a declaration that you're not going to learn anything using Lord God and Jesus Christ, but yet for some 30 years or so, he used Lord God and Jesus Christ. It seems like a conundrum. Like why now we can't use Lord God and Jesus Christ? What does it matter? You follow? If we know that the Lord is the Father, and we know that God is Elohim, and then if we know that Jesus Christ is just the American version of Yahshua, what does it matter? Is the logical questions I have. I'll read something. I'm speaking with somebody in business, and you know, you always come across someone who means well, that loves the Lord, that always want to tell you about what you need to do, you know. And sometimes I'm not often the kindest person in my texting to people, but so I can rub people the wrong way. And nonetheless, I try to watch myself, but then they want to express and put God on me. And I'm not asking for any of that. I just want to do the business. But yet, nonetheless, they're so righteous and pious in their concept that they still want to exert their knowledge on me, right? So it's funny, and we're just speaking about how people want to keep with their own agenda. Mm-hmm. Now, I address her in a kind way about the name being Yahshua and not Jesus Christ. I'm getting off my topic of business, right? In order to address this, because it's becoming too much. And I give her some scriptures, Isaiah and John 43, I've come in my Father's name and you receive me not, right? And I tell her to read that. Why would the book say such a thing? And we wonder why people are so lost and confused. But nonetheless, her reply, yes, thank you for correcting me. We have a ministry. This is a very big group. They named it El Shaddai, the God more than enough. Although that is the real name, this is a text I just got last yesterday with someone in 2022. Although that is the real name, everybody call him Jesus Christ, the only Son of the Father, who is, who was, and who is to come. To know God and to serve God is my only desire in life. So be it. Amen. Thank you for sharing what I had already laid out to her, showing the scripture. She never gave me a scripture about anything, Jesus Christ, Lord God. And she had already said a whole lot before I went ahead and got off my wagon and addressed the comment, right? In order to hopefully squash the desire that she has in her to impart to me about something. But yet she evidently said, thank you for correcting me. And although that is the real name, they disobedient, go ahead and use. And this is a real life text, right? And we've all encountered that conversation with people from time. Buddy, you brought in a person and that you met at the gym, and they came down to class. That's right. And we went over the names, but still no comprende. Right. No comprende. No understanding. No. Don't care. To want to even use the name, because, hey, it satisfied my mama, my grandmama, my minister, and a whole big group of people in a group called El Shaddai, right. As though they know that name is something, or title. El Shaddai is a title, it's not even a name, and that in that title, they taking it because they don't even know. They don't even realize that name El, or that title El Shaddai, was what Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob referred to him as. And they just missed the whole conversation with Moses and that burning bush, and where they start with that Bible at, and how that name is given into Moses, and how Moses had to begin that trek to come down. So the book is antiquated, and I use the word phantological. It's whatever they want it to be. Jesus Christ is good enough for me is how they express it. And like what Hartchins was expressing, that we try to belabor and go over the unity of the Spirit, how we break down Yahweh being both masculine and feminine, correct? Mm-hmm. Within himself. Needs nothing in order to create anything. He's self-sufficient in and alone and by himself as Yahweh. You follow? In this state and condition, he's pure spirit, which includes Elohim and Yahshua. Keep in mind, Elohim and Yahshua are the same thing, the same spirit. It was not Elohim that created the creation, and then Yahshua got in it. That's not how it go. We know John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with Yahweh. That Word was Yahshua the Messiah. And like Hartin said, This is a little difficult. This is one of the first charts, right? His name chart, because we got to get the name correct. And it is somewhat baffling, because how can Elohim be a title when you come to learn? Elohim's a title, just like El Shaddai, the Almighty Provider, El Shaddai. And then Elohim, the descriptive word of Elohim, is what Yahweh gave himself to describe himself. And that description is Ayah, Asher, Ayah. I will be what I will to be. I will to be a chair. I will to be a rod. I will to be a chart. I will to be a pen or an eraser. Or any such thing he wants. Everything is what he will to be. And that's descriptive of Elohim. Is why you have the El in Daniel and Ezekiel. That is a description. It's a description. And what it is a state and condition that's incorporeal, whereby you have that word or son. We express Yahshua as the one that got on the cross, because he was that specially prepared body that we talk about in Isaiah, the 53rd chapter. Can you read that for me real quick? Please. Isaiah 53. Because what we're looking at is a manifestation, because if we drew the tabernacle, and everything's patterned after the tabernacle, right? If everything's patterned after the tabernacle, you have Yahweh, right? You have Elohim, and you have Yahshua. And these are three different states. And we say this is like concrete. We say this is concrete. This is liquid. And this is vapor. Threes, correct? Concrete. We leave Yahshua. We leave because we say Yahshua. Yahshua. We leave Yahshua in that state. That's the only way I can express it. Because we have him on the cross. And just like the text said, he done came. He done gone. And he's supposed to come again. That's what they think. They concrete. He's flesh. They don't know how he rose a quickening spirit. Or they don't acknowledge when we read there in the scriptures where we can pull it out where he rose a quickening spirit. They bypass that. Just like they bypass the name that was given to Moses at the burning bush. They've read it. She said, we believe that you're correct. But they want to use El Shaddai or some other such erroneous name. So it's not like a mystery. This is that they can't see the significance and how that will help them overcome their egotistical, misdirected person, because they don't think they got one. Their conscience, they ain't got a conscience. We say to people, the murders that we see and the mayhem that go out, man, how can a guy, you know, blast down a group, a school, and shoot down this and cause mayhem? They had no conscience. They had no conscience to, but Yahweh caused that activity, that happening. Because they get out, and sometimes you hear them, you hear the stories. I don't know what got in me. Oh, I'm so sorry. Get those instances when you have that those passion murders. They just wild out. They black out. I don't know what it's in me. But hey, we have to see when we say concrete, and it's vapor, liquid, and concrete or ice, right? We use water. I'm getting this from the water principle that we often use, right? Water is a vapor. How did I say? Water, right? H2O. Is a vapor, is a liquid, is concrete. And we think that that's just Yahweh, vapor. He's in the sky. It's Elohim. He's moving around some kind of way in this incorporeal state. And then Yahshua in this concrete state, in this, when he came on earth. And as we spoke about on Tuesday, he's not there. He's not there. He doesn't reside there. That was never his abode. Read Isaiah 53. Prepared sacrificial body. The beginning, I think.
Isaiah 53.
Mm-hmm.
Now,
this is a report that we're giving about this man, Yahshua. This is what Isaiah, because remember, the scriptures are about Yahshua. John 5 and 39, correct? Mm-hmm. Now there's a report. Isaiah is already a prophet. The Spirit's writing through Isaiah. We say, again, as we said in the moderation, the Holy Spirit, in a body or out of a body. Therefore, you can't keep them in a concrete state. If that would help you, it would help you recognize when we say Yahshua and Elohim are the self-same thing. At a point in time, he came in through the loins of the Virgin Mary. Who do you know that's on earth came in without a physical, biological father? But you'll believe Mary was immaculately conceived by the archangel Gabriel. You'll believe that, but then one would still consider he's in a body. He's flesh and blood. He's spirit. They hung the flesh on the cross. That's it. Therefore, they take away the concept because, hey, he's the Holy Spirit. This is spirit in this condition, incorporeal. Hey, they didn't see Yahshua neither. They did it. When he rose, a quickening spirit, and he was on earth and tarried for 40 days, fulfilling the 40 years that they were here in the wilderness, everybody didn't see Yahshua. And when he was here in this physical body before he died, they didn't see that he was the God on earth. They didn't. They missed him. Keep reading about the report.
Who has believed our report?
Uh-huh.
And to whom is the arm of Yahweh revealed?
Got to be revealed by Yahweh. As Hartis said, hey, she can replay and replay and replay. But unless one's broken down and understands how what we're expressing, what the report is about, I'm telling you, Yahshua is not flesh and blood. Keep reading.
For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant,
mm-hmm.
and as a root out of a dry ground.
Mm-hmm.
He hath no form nor comeliness.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And that's what they did. They did not desire him. He had no beauty. He was a comely man. Prepared that way. Before the foundation of the world. As we all are. Because you are not just flesh and blood either. You are spirit. Embodied in a fleshly body. And you have to believe that. And many people don't believe. Keep reading. Mm-hmm.
A man of sorrow and acquainted with grief.
Mm-hmm.
And we hid, as it were, our faces from him.
Mm-hmm.
He was despised, and we esteemed him not.
Mm-hmm.
Surely he has borne our pain and carried our diseases. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of Elohim, and afflicted.
That way we think that he was a physical guy. When we're reading over this, that is written by the Holy Spirit, through the hands of Isaiah, but you have to recognize that that spirit is testifying about him that's going to be coming. That's why it's so coincidental. Some would say, well, man, it's said in the prophets are talking about Yahshua, the Messiah. Well, keep reading.
But he was wounded for our transgressions.
Mm-hmm.
Now he's
doing something for us. It wasn't that physical body doing anything. It was the spirit in that body doing what it was doing. They couldn't kill the spirit. They can only take care, they can only have addressed the body, and that's what they was beating. And that's what everybody's argument is about today when we go against one another. We're beating flesh. Because spirit, you can't destroy spirit. You can't get rid of spirit. And so when people want to do hellacious act, you know, hellacious crimes, they thinking they're eradicating and getting rid of something. And they go bang, 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 and they're out there. But no, you just cause problems. You're just causing mayhem because you think that flesh is against you. It's set up. It's set up. And when it's not strong enough, don't have a foundation of the reality, trying to keep what they want. That's why we should say, thank you for telling me the truth, and I believe it. That is the name. But there's a veil that cannot be rent in twain, and Yahweh ain't put it in there. I'm not kicking about it. I'm not bellyaching about it. I ain't writing nothing back. Good, bad, or indifferent. I just need her to be able to sign on the dotted line when we finish the business. You follow? Hello. And I'll be fair about it. And that's it. I'm not chasing no one down a rabbit hole to get them to hear and believe what I've come by grace that Yahweh allowed me to hear. I got cousins that grew up and sat in the same seats down there at 1040 South Grand with me. Where they at? I'm not mad about it. It's Yahweh will. Some he pick, some he don't. And by grace, that he may keep me in steadfast in his arms, shielded by him. Learning with everyone here about showing someone what is the reality about Yahweh. Keep reading about Yahshua, about a specially prepared sacrificial body, knowing it was going to have to be sacrificed. Read.
He was bruised for our iniquities.
Mm-hmm.
The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes we are healed.
Mm-hmm.
All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to...
See, all that's allegorical. All that has to be understood. Those stripes are the whips that he was taking from here out on Golgotha, of seeing how those statements, we're all gone away as sheep. Everybody uses the word sheep. Everybody has an idea about the sheep and the shepherd. But they looking at as their minister, as they're being, that as though that's their shepherd. Yeah. As though they're part of that church's flock. That's not what it's talking about. There ain't but one shepherd. And that's Yahshua the Messiah. And he's not flesh and blood. He is spirit. He materialized as Yahshua Messiah for some 33 and a half years. That's all that happened. And then he took off the flesh. No different than he transformed from Yahweh pure spirit into Yahweh or Elohim. No different. He didn't come out of Mary's womb. And she was amazed herself. Wow. Wow. And he said from early on that he's about his father's business. Well, his father's spirit. He's not talking about Joseph. He wasn't a carpenter. They want to belabor that issue as though he was, but he was fulfilling. He was not a carpenter. He was fulfilling what he instituted. And because people think Joseph, his stepdad, if you want to call it that, was a carpenter, you say, well, Jesus was a carpenter. You put him right back down into the flesh. You make him be just as Joseph was. Now realizing that he said his father is Yahweh and Yahweh's spirit. Therefore, he was not a carpenter. He went through the motions. He helped build on the tabernacle or the temple, however that worked. But he himself was spirit materialized for a particular purpose, for a particular job. And that was to get sacrificed on this chart or on this cross for us. They had their way of escape through John the Baptist, because that's all he was dealing with at that time, was that nation of people. Joshua specifically. And they getting baptized of John the Baptist was their way of escape. Then when come Joshua on the cross, and when he died and was buried and resurrected, and then he ascended unto the Father on high, and then 10 days later, he's come again. See, in my text, I read that she said he's soon to come.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
He's residing here now in the hearts and minds of those who believe the report. He's not coming from anywhere. He's here. What's coming is a universal revelation within all men's minds as to who and what he is. That's not coming from anywhere. It's just going to be a moment and a twinkling of an eye, and you'll recognize, good, bad, or indifferent, and either you are or you're not. There's not going to be no learning curve or no extended course or no makeup course at that time. That's what we're expressing, is the urgency of being saved in the name of Yahshua Messiah. Acts 4 and 12. Please.
Acts 4 and 12. This is the stone which was set at naught of your build of you, which is become the head of the corner.
That's Yahshua the Messiah. Not Peter. See, the whole world got Peter being the cornerstone. That's why they done built him up as Peter or St. Petersburg Cathedral in Italy, right? They think they have him set up as the cornerstone, the first pope. And it's been expressed that he didn't even go or travel to Rome. But yet, how she just read that, people interpret that as though he was the first stone. Reread, please. Reread.
This is the stone.
This is the stone. They looking at him as the stone. Just as they said, take this, eat, is my body. And that's why they have the whole world taking communion and not knowing anything about this or that. Because when you break it down, he didn't give them bread to eat, as though that was part of his body. Because he said he was the bread. Keep reading.
This is the stone which was set at naught of you builders, which is become the head of the corner. Neither is there salvation in any other. For there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved.
That's the name. And that name is not Jesus Christ. And people want to poo-poo and just think that it's not relevant. Now, back to this. If we have this tabernacle, it's set up as 1, 2, 3. You have Yahshua, Yahshua. He died and he went up to you and he, how shall I explain? Wow. All right. No. This is a spiritual kingdom on earth, right? Colossians 1 and 13, please. Now that meat made us meet together in a certain fashion, perfectly fit and joined together in understanding. You follow? According to the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah. This is how we were meeting and coming together, because we are hearing something of one accord, if you would. That's the meeting that he's talking about. Read.
Which has made us fit to be partakers. See?
And we're going to be fit to be partakers of the sons in the light or the knowledge of Yahshua the Messiah. Okay, read. Now look, we've been delivered from the power of darkness. Where is darkness on this migratory pattern? If anybody can tell me. I don't want to let the cat out the bag. It's the court roundabout. It's Egypt. Correct? Now look, this is court roundabout. This is equated to Egypt. You follow?
Yeah.
Egypt, right? This is darkness. Right? Yahshua came down into darkness. He came down at 30 years old and raised them up. Right? He came down into at 30 years old and began the ministry. For what? In order to save our souls, correct? So he had to come down into this state. Now, is he going to reside here forever and ever? You shake your head. Did you know or not know? Is he going to reside here forever and ever? He's here within us, the sons of light. But it's spiritual. We're not dealing with Moses back here or Noah or Moses and these times back here, this first covenant that was given to the Jews. We're not dealing with the Abrahamic promise and things of that nature. We're using that information about Noah and the ark and how it showed an upper deck, a middle deck, and a lower deck. We're seeing the Spirit and how it was operating down through the dispensations and ages. We are using that because the Messiah said he's not come to destroy the law and the prophets, because that's also what this is. Not only 4,000 years, but it's the law and the prophets. You follow me? And we're not destroying that. But this was in darkness. Because, hey, this is the spiritual kingdom on earth. So therefore, you have to psychologically, according to your conscience, start seeing things according to a spiritual reality. Don't believe it? Hold on. Don't believe it? What do you mean a spiritual reality? How am I supposed to walk around with a spiritual? Got a pamphlet, got textbooks, got things we can use in order to help, hopefully, get this one. The clergy has ignorantly called Yahshua the Messiah a liar in saying that he instituted rather than fulfill carnal ordinances. Okay? I want to go to the back of the book, and you have examples in the back of the book. I don't know, can you find that on there, the net? Because I wanted to make it very clear that there is a spiritual reality that once we see and understand the report, we're just not belaboring blood, water, spirit 40, blood, water, spirit 40. We do use it, and we'll maintain using it forever and ever. Never going to go away. But there has to be a spiritual reality to come. It's going to be at the end of that book. It's going to be at the end that I want. All right. So we got Yahshua down here in darkness, and we're just reading where we're reading at, right? So, you know what I want, Eunice? No? Okay, just get right here. Just get on me and show her in the book, and then I want to keep reading about this darkness. Because we got to pull Yahshua out. He doesn't stay in this condition is what I'm expressing. Yeah, you saw that? That's what we're going to go back to the scripture in Colossians.
Right.
1:13, about that death in Egypt.
13. Who has delivered us from the power of darkness?
Now we've been delivered from the power of darkness. Read.
And has translated us into the kingdom of his dear son.
Now he's been translated into a kingdom of his dear son. His Yahweh's dear son, translated, meaning moved from Egypt,
right,
or this court roundabout into this holy place, if you would. That's getting Yahshua out of the flesh.
Right.
Now, if you've been translated and you can see the report, and you're going to be able to maintain your conscience, you're not maintaining your conscience, but the belief in that report, it will elevate you, just as we get elevated, as you hear a speaker speak and you follow along with what's being said, and you're getting elevated and being immersed in the name of Yahshua the Messiah, or in the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah. You're being elevated outside of your egotistical, misdirected personality. And we sometimes we say, well, we fall. Well, hey, there is an upward and downward pattern, but we are to know that and not be moved by every wind of doctrine. Why you're down dealing in the earth plane. That's why Yahshua did ascend, but he did return. He returned in the hearts and minds of men. But Yahshua, Yahshua is not in the earth plane and not coming back anymore. He's going to be revealed by the sons who preach the gospel, which is who he is. Keep reading. Mm-hmm.
Even the forgiveness of sin.
Now that redemption to his blood, what is that? Can't go find Yahshua's blood. That's 2,000 years ago. You have to understand the blood according to this bloodline. This is the blood that we are now expressing in order to run a line down through the period of time. This is the water line that we see, that his water, because out when they pierced him, out came forth blood and water. Now, he just said blood there, but we understand that there's a water prison line and there's a spirit line. That has to be understood as the basics in order to bring a person up to see the spirit operating. Keep reading there.
Who is the image of the invisible El, the first cause of all creation?
Now, that's the image of the first cause of all creation. That's Yahshua. Not separate. He was here. He was back here with Moses. And he was the first cause of all creation. Keep reading.
For by him were all things created.
For by Yahshua, the one that think that he just came in at the late freight, at the end of 4,000 years, just coming to be the son, as it were, and just To set as the clergy say, an example, right, or a institution of something. That's not what he came for. Now realizing that he came and set everything up and created everything. It just didn't pop up here, come out of some woman's loins as a regular old child. We read there in Isaiah that he was a specially prepared sacrifice that you couldn't see him coming. Didn't want to see him. And beat him at that. They did. And we beat him now in saying that I don't believe that the name is Yahweh. You beat him when you say I prefer Jesus the Christ. And as nice as you want to be, and you want to hold on to that egotistical, misdirected personality about the creator of heaven and earth, woe unto you is all I have to say. Keep reading.
For by him were all things created, yeah, that are in heaven and that are in earth.
Uh-huh.
Visible and invisible.
Visible and invisible. He created that. Yahshua the Messiah. Because hey, once Yahshua created Elohim, he took off, he put on his working clothes, and Yahweh went out of the creating business. He created his only begotten son. And his son was Yahshua the Messiah. Keep reading.
Whether they be thrones or dominions, mm-hmm, principalities or
She have a power. She started doing some voodoo with me through texting and stuff. That I my attitude was wrong and whatnot because she didn't like how I was speaking. So I had to put all that. I just changed it, just shut all that up, right? Because she thinks she have some power, some principality because she walking in the name of Jesus Christ. Yeah. That's how they feel that they have a power and they're gonna be able to exert themselves on me. And they do it to us. But that's an outward demonstration. But I know I have my own powers that come that I have to be able to put down too. And this is what we're going to look at as far as the spiritual aspect of it. That's physical. That's a physical text from a physical woman. I ain't got no problem. I'm not kicking against that. But that's a physical thing. But then I have a psychological thing or a spiritual fulfillment in me. I can't fix that. I can't fix her. I say I'm running out to her to save her no kind of way. But me, there's a spiritual fulfillment for me or for we that we can correct. Keep reading.
All things were created by him and for him.
Right.
And he is before all things.
Yes.
And in him all things have been permanently placed.
That's in Yahshua, the Messiah.
Right.
From here, before the creation, until he came down here at 30 years old into Egypt, into darkness, and to institute the things he instituted with the children of Israel, and until he came some 2,000 years later as Yahshua the Messiah through the loins of the Virgin Mary in order to fulfill that spiritual fulfillment that he set up. Now, that's what we can see, and people get wrapped up in that, and that's beautiful to see those correlations work. I mean, Will Williams often says you have to see or make those correlations. What I'm meaning, this is the Lamb of Yahweh. Hey, we have read there in Matthew how John said, "Behold, the Lamb of Yahweh who cometh to take away the sins of the world." That Lamb is the same Lamb that they digested down here in Egypt. You follow? That's a correlation that we're making according to a spiritual principle, right? And we have to see that according to what's been written in the book. But then there is an ascension or a spiritual fulfillment, not of that, but of our own reckoning. And when we go to this pamphlet, and let's grab baptism. That's an easy one. No one wants to talk about baptism anymore because everybody knows water is not going to wash away sin. So we know we're not going to get in no water, and everybody who want to get in the water is going to be wrong. That's what we say now. It should be the first one, page 34. Yeah, just start of the law, because what we're having, okay, great, she has it on the monitor. So you got baptism, going to scroll. Yes, let's go ahead and read the drafts shown on the following pages, and it explains what we're talking about. Because I made the comment, there's a spiritual fulfillment that we have to recognize. And we don't often recognize because we stay down here in Egypt. We don't realize that we're in a spiritual kingdom age and we have to see things according to a spiritual understanding. That's the fulfillment that ought to be in you. Not just getting the correlations and going through the blood, water, spirit, fully only. Because, hey, there's an ascension too. There's a death, burial, resurrection, and ascension. Well, that extension is a spiritual fulfillment of that spiritual principle being risen up in your heart and mind, or our heart and mind, right? Not just staying down here and seeing that. That's fine for what it is. People have all over the world. We see nature lovers. They have binoculars, and they study birds, and they study whales, and they study animals, and they do all the wonderful things for us to see. But then what? It's all for Yahweh's purpose. And he see the beauty, and we go around saying, Yahweh's great. Man, look at the beautiful colors. Look at the animals, what they do, and they procreate. And, oh, this is so wonderful. And for what? for mankind to come and destroy all man so bad, and that they destroyed all the animals that God had made. And that's not what it is. But we're going to get back to it. Hey, wait, go ahead. Just start it on the shot screen.
Mm-hmm. How that Joshua, the Elohim of Israel, appeared by vision to Moses, shown on the left, instituting the law contained in the first five books called the Pentateuch, also prophesied to men of old, instituting the prophets. At the right, this same Elohim manifested in a physical form of Joshua the Messiah. Fulfilled the same law and prophets, including everything as far back as 4,000 years BY, including the first man, Adam, a figure of the second Adam, Yahshua, the Messiah. Finally, this same Elohim took off the flesh and made his abode within the man, beginning on the day of Pentecost.
Reread that again. Reread that again, because what I said was that Yahshua didn't go away and stay away. And this is proving that he's not coming no kind of way. And we just read it right here, clear as day. Let's read.
Finally,
the same Yahshua
took off the flesh
when he died. He was buried, and he resurrected. That's taken off the flesh. He rose a quickening spirit. He abided on earth for 40 days. He ascended up into heaven. And then he came back out and did what? Read.
And made his abode within the man, beginning on the day of Pentecost, the fulfillment of the promise that he, Yahweh Elohim, would write his law in their heart and mind, which constituted the New Testament, our covenant, written by the Holy Spirit.
Written by the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost, when he went into the hearts and minds of men. That's Yahshua, the Holy Spirit, doing all of that for the fulfillment of what he came in to do. Of fulfilling the promise that was given to Abraham. This is what we're set up. And he's abiding in us. And now we're going to go through the baptism or immersion exercise. Okay? And we're going to scroll back down right there. Because we got to see this institution of the law and the prophets. That's showing it's being instituted. Then we're going to see how the Messiah fulfilled it. You follow? And we're going to read down primarily through Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. But he's not fulfilling that in a New Testament period. He's fulfilling that while under the law. Yahshua is fulfilling.
Right.
Then we're going to see the spiritual fulfilling that ought to take up residence in us. Not just, hey, it is knowing how this is working, the law and the prophets, no doubt. But then it's also a spiritual fulfillment of how you are to be spiritually minded according to what you've been shown and what we do see as we see things throughout nature that's beautiful. And it gives a reflection of what Yahweh is. But that also is in you. So let's just start with Exodus 14 and 22. We don't have to grab the book verses because it merely states the verse within this read. But we will grab at the spiritual fulfillment portion of it. Go ahead and read.
Exodus 14:22, Holy Name Bible. And the children of Israel went into the midst of the sea upon the dry ground, and the waters were a wall unto them on their right hand, on their right hand and on their left.
Mm-hmm.
1 Corinthians.
Now that's a statement about that baptism, about when the children of Israel went through the Red Sea. Okay? Now we're going to have 1 Corinthians, Saul talking about this, confirming that same event. Read.
1 Corinthians 12:13.
Scroll up a little bit. No, I'm telling her it's right there.
For by one spirit are we all whether we be Jews or priests, whether we be bond or free, and have been made, all made, to drink into one spirit. But the...
Where are you at reading that? You reading Moreover, brethren?
No, she's reading the spiritual.
No, I don't want the spiritual. Just read it off the, you have the booklet right there.
Yeah. 1 Corinthians 10, 1 and 2, Holy Name Bible. Moreover, brethren, I would not that ye should be ignorant how that all our fathers were under the cloud and all passed through the sea, and were all immersed unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea.
Now that immersion is the baptism that happened under the law. Now we're going to the prophets. Scroll back down and then... So we can see it in the screen. Oh, you got
Ezekiel 36:25, Holy Name Bible. Then will I sprinkle clean water upon you, and ye shall be clean from all your filthiness, and from all your idols will I cleanse you.
Now you see, Catholicism, they sprinkle as their immersion. They don't dunk people in the water. Christians, typically, they're stopping the dunking, but they use the dunking or the immersing or putting people in the water. But they're pulling out these scriptures, not knowing how they apply and not knowing the significance of them. Now we know in that baptism or immersion, whichever one you can put sprinkle up there too. Because what it's expressing is that Ezekiel, by the Spirit, is saying he's going to be clean, he's going to clean you up. Just like when they put you in water, they think you're going to be cleansed of sin. But we know that water won't wash away a person's consciousness. So what needs to be washed, this is a type and a shadow that was set up by the law of what Moses went through in the children of Israel. We have the prophet looking back at this event of it being cleaned up because, hey, 3 days they had to be at the base of that mountain cleaned up and be able to receive the word of Yahweh at the base of that mountain on that first trip. And this is what the prophet's looking at, because that already transpired. He's realized they had to be cleaned, but that's not going to be the full cleaning. So we're not going to go run back 4,000 years and say, oh, I got to do what Moses do. We're not doing that. We're just saying that that's what was done. Now we're going to have Yahshua come in. Read Matthew 3:13.
Matthew 3:13-15, Holy Name Bible. Then cometh Yahshua from Galilee to Jordan unto John to be immersed of him.
They're going
to
be immersed. This is Yahshua going to be immersed. This is Yahshua going to be fulfilling that which he had the children of Israel do. Because if you read over here in 14th chapter of Exodus, you see that Yahshua was there telling Moses to raise your hand in order to part the Red Sea. That was Yahshua doing that. And so he instituted that with the children of Israel. Now yes, Yahshua is going to be fulfilling that because he's going to get immersed by John the Baptist or the last prophet. Keep reading.
But John forbade him, saying, mm-hmm. I have need to be immersed of thee.
Mm-hmm.
And comest thou to me? And Yahshua answering said unto him, permit it to be so now that thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. Then he permitted him.
And he did that. Yahshua got down in water in order to perform that act, and that was only to fulfill that which was set up in Exodus. That's clear as day, and people can see that. And if you've been blessed enough to see that little tidbit, you're on your way. But be mindful, there's a spiritual fulfillment too. Just having a bunch of knowledge is not going to do you any bit of good. We see that manifested throughout the world. We heard a testimony of that tonight about them at one time having awareness and then apparently at another time later on don't have an awareness. Been swept away. Been cleaned and garnished. And that what's the parable of the bridesmaid with the oil and I not having anything to, not having the oil. With the lampstands, yeah, not having their oil.
Right.
Now you got a whole classroom in it, throughout, you got many classes throughout the country with no oil in them. With no oil in them to preach the gospel. And it's so egregious you don't even want to go back and listen to it, afraid to get swept up. By the time you got off of this concept of, oh, I need to do this Christian-like and this Christian-like, and by the time you get off of that bandwagon, when you see, oh, you didn't believe the report, that, hey, the report was that Yahshua came in to fulfill, holy smokes, I'm good with that, and you'd be thankful for that, right? But some people, they go back to their own vomit, and they go back, and then their first estate is worse than their last estate. Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 12 and 13, Holy Name Bible. If we can grab that out of the book, Eunice, we can grab these out of the book. Now, remember, we're talking about a baptism or we're talking about an immersion. Now, whether you've been baptized when you're younger or older, by the time you did come into the reality and see what the purpose of the baptism was for, then you're fine. Whether you was or whether we had it, I think that's why the 1 Corinthians 8 yesterday or on Tuesday was so beautiful. Whether you eat it or whether you don't eat it, it doesn't make a difference. Whether you're on the, whether you put it on the altar or whether you ate it off the altar, we're not looking at water baptism in that fashion. So now once we get an understanding that this was what the story was about and we learn the various different events and how it works, the law of prophet fulfillment, you get stronger in that storytelling, if you would, right? But what we want to take away is here, 1 Corinthians 12, 13. What? Type to her. Mm-hmm. All right. So, go ahead, read. First Corinthians. What was that, 12? Now, by one Spirit, now we have to realize that the one Spirit is Yahshua, or the one Spirit is Yahweh, in two manifestations of Elohim and Yahshua. Read. Now, this is the point of what we're supposed to be gathering. Reread that one more time, please.
For by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body.
Now, this is the significance of understanding how that baptism was set up by Yahshua the Messiah with the children of Israel going through the Red Sea, how it was fulfilled by Yahshua at the River Jordan with John, and now how we now, after the Pentecost, because that spiritual fulfillment is coming after Pentecost. They didn't receive the spiritual or significance of the understanding of why they were being baptized of John. Right. Not as we are to understand it now. And therefore now our spiritual reality, neither Jew nor Gentile, neither bond nor free, neither male nor female. Can a female preacher teach Jesus Christ? Or what? Yeah, of course. We're not bellyaching over that anymore. Right. We've come out of that concept of a dead state of thinking that that law meant that only men can do what men did.
Right?
Right? Read.
For the body is not one member, but many.
That's that meeting again that we read earlier in the scriptures about how we're going to be made fit according to the gospel of Yahshua Messiah. And when we see how we make fit and we meet together according to his doctrine, because there's only but one gospel. There's not many different gospels, not many different ways. He said, Yahshua would say, he's the way, the truth, and the life. That's it. So if you're going to come up with some other, you're going to try to creep in through the temple some other kind of way, it's not going to work. You got to come in through the straight gate. And we're giving you the report, the straight of it. Keep reading. Yeah.
I am not of the body. Is it therefore not of the body?
So we get all that. We read that. It's all the body, whatever your member is, whatever your job is. But your job is not vacuuming. Your job is not writing this. It's not physical jobs. It's a spiritual understanding. It's a spiritual job that you have to get your spiritual self in alignment with the gospel. Not the do's and don'ts. It's a necessity to do. But that's not the only thing that's becoming of you to be a vacuum cleaner or a door opener in the gospel. No, it's to be able to teach and preach the gospel of Yahshua Messiah. Or be steadfast in your consciousness about being or serving in that whatever light that is. Keep reading. Let's go to Galatians 3 and 27.
Galatians 3, 27. Mm-hmm. For as many of you as have been baptized in the Messiah.
Oh, how are you going to be baptized? You're going to be baptized in the Messiah? Was Yahshua the Messiah? Was Yahshua the Messiah? Is what I'm asking. Is the question? Yeah. That was right. Is that how are you gonna get? How are you get baptized in a physical guy? You're not gonna get baptized. I'm just making the point that we're experiencing all that you might want to consider who he and what he was. You have to ultimately come into a concept that a reality that he was the Holy Spirit. In the body for a period of time, 33 and a half years, and then out of the body. And he remained out of the body for 50 days until he got back in the body of those on the day of Pentecost. In this age, the spiritual kingdom age, and those that believe the report look to Yahshua, which is spirit, in a kingdom on earth. No longer dilly-dallying with the layman, if you would. Those that know not Yahweh. Only they come, only preach and teach as we're moved by the Holy Spirit. Don't know? Go find out. Keep reading, please. To put on the Messiah. You put on the Messiah. You are as Elohim. But you have to believe it. Not just sugarcoat it. Not just be in the group. You have to understand how these correlations work and how they fit. This is why we belabor the group. We can talk fast and mightily esoteric and lofty and fast. But I didn't learn like that. I learned over and over repeating these things, and you see coming into an awareness how these things work. That by the pattern. And it's not a one-time gig. You see it one day and then forget it. You know how to correlate nothing. But that's that spirit working within you to sure you up in order when you get back here and see how that immersion is solely of Yahshua the Messiah. Keep reading, please. Galatians.
There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither bond nor free. There is neither male nor female. For ye are all one in Yahshua the Messiah.
Mm-hmm.
Oh,
if you be the Messiahs, you are the Messiahs. If you believe in the report that's been given, read.
Mm-hmm.
Now you're Abraham's seed according to the Spirit. Read.
And heirs according to the promise.
Which was spirit. That was a spiritual promise given to Abraham. But you have a whole world, a whole nation of Israelites wanting to come back and say they're from the actual, literal, physical lineage of Abraham. And they got, and they're on, the Muslims or whatever, yeah, but they're coming from Abraham through Ishmael, but they literally try to find their whole roots back to Abraham. But this is not what we're looking at, because we're in a spiritual kingdom, and that has to be recognized all the days while we're residing here. It would help take away a lot of our misconceptions about life, about the things around us, if we recognize that everything is spirit. We say it, but we don't oftentimes believe that everything is just spirit materialized in order to learn something about your creator, which is Yahshua. And you have to begin to take the truth for what the truth is, and not just, as my friend through my text said, you're right, thank you, but I'll just stick with my Jesus. C'est la vie. Have at it. But if you believe and you take things and know that everything is just material, spirit materialized, you have to call a spade a spade. Anything else there? Read. That's good. Let's grab John 7 and 28. Mm-hmm.
In the last day, the great day of the feast, Yahshua stood and cried.
Now the last day of the great day of the feast, when is he writing that? That's in John. What age and dispensation is he in writing that? No, well, making this statement, that Yahshua is making this statement. Can you catch Yahshua making, or was that all red letters up above there? He believeth on. That wasn't 7:28, was it? You got it, Eunice? Yeah.
Start at 25. The end said, the Jews among themselves, whither will he go that we shall not find him? Will he go unto the dispersion among the nations and teach the nations? What manner of saying is this that he said, ye shall seek me and shall not find me? And where I am, thither ye cannot come.
What verse you on?
26.
All right.
Ready?
That's John 7. Read the King James Version for me. 7:25. Let's start at 7:21 in King James, please. Got to catch the continuity of the thought. Because we're talking about spiritual things, correct? And we have to see things coming down from a man who's writing or saying those things in the fourth dispensation. Huh? Yeah, I know, but then we got to see it read down through. If you start at 25 or 21, 7:21, and catch the thought, Yahshua answered and said unto them.
And many of the people believed on him and said, when the Messiah
comes. Hold on, you reading Holy Name or you reading King James?
Well, I guess you said read it at the Holy Name of
the King James of the 21. Yeah.
I have done one work, and ye all marvel. Moses therefore gave unto you circumcision.
Okay.
Not because it is of Moses, but of the fathers. And ye on the Sabbath day circumcise a man. If a man on the Sabbath day receives circumcision, that the law of Moses should not be broken, are ye angry at me because I have made a man every whit whole on the Sabbath day?
You understand? That's a story that he set up. That Yahweh and the Jews are having a problem with him making them do something on the Sabbath day, but he's putting it in their head and say, hey, if you're of the Moses' the circumcision and it falls on that seventh day, what are you going to do? You going to do the work or are you going to do the circumcision? You're at a conundrum. Same thing with 1 Corinthians in 8, talking about you're going to give a sacrifice or you're going to eat the sacrifice. What are you going to do? Because he's letting them know that all this time is going to be over with after I die and resurrect. He's letting them know in the fourth dispensation that you're going to have a problem if you don't change your thinking about Sabbath days and circumcisions. That's what they were jamming him about in the fourth dispensation. I know John is writing it over here in the fifth age, but we're looking at their red letters being said here. And that's going to help distinguish why circumcisions and baptisms are no more required. And now that we understand that, keep reading. We're going to find it because he's going to come up out of this spirit, out of this flesh here in a minute. Keep reading.
Judge not according to the appearance.
Judge righteous judgment. That's what the scripture reading was about the righteous judgments of things tonight, right? Because not of the things of which you appear to be and how you think you look or what you feel you like. It's not coming that way no more. He's talking about that in this fourth dispensation. We should be well beyond physical things by now in the fifth age. In the fourth age, in the sixth dispensation. We should not be bellying about the same things he's letting them know don't belly about no more. But keep reading. Okay.
Is not this he that they speak ill?
Mm-hmm.
But no,
he speaketh
boldly,
and they
say nothing unto him.
Mm-hmm.
Do the rulers know indeed that this is the very Yahshua?
Yeah, they were amazed at what he's saying boldly, what he's saying. Are we supposed to come boldly before the throne of Yahweh and preach the gospel of Yahshua Messiah and let none other doctrine supersede or take you away from this doctrine? So there's no more. Yeah, she can text me all she want. I'm not going nowhere on that flimsy bit of information. You follow me? But keep reading.
Howbeit, we know this man whence he is, but whom Yahshua cometh, no man knoweth whence he is.
See, no man knoweth. They didn't know the spirit that was in the man. It wasn't the man. They knew who Yahshua was as a physical guy. We never met Yahshua in a physical body. The only way we're going to meet Yahshua is through the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah. That's how we're going to meet him. Yeah, we say our first aim is to help you find and know Yahweh our Elohim and Yahshua. And this is how we're finding them. And even them back there with them, handling them, touching them, didn't see them neither. So he's not flesh, he is spirit, and we have to see him according to the spirit, not a physical guy on a cross. Keep reading. Now we're going to get into 28, of when we're talking about a spiritual understanding about immersion now. Read. He ain't crying mad, he crying letting them know in the temple what? Is that Joseph?
No.
Was that Joseph that sent him?
No.
Well, you know that's the spirit that sent him. And if that spirit is the same spirit that's bearing witness in his physical body, making him want to do what he's got to do. Read.
But I know him, for I am from him. No. Oh.
That's right. That's John. That's the word. In the beginning was the word. And the word was Yahweh. Get my drift? He was with Yahweh from the beginning. That's him in Psalms, the 28th division. That was him in Isaiah 53. That was the spirit, not the physical body, but the spirit that's recognizing spirit of the Father telling him to do this and do that. And we're to take on that same nature through the gospel, and we have to believe it. Keep reading. You'll see.
Then they sought to take him,
See, that belief is not the same belief that we to have. That's not the same belief. They don't know why or how he not get taken there at that time. They don't know those things. Yeah. But they believe in read. Keep reading.
When the Messiah cometh, will he do more miracles than these which this man has done? The Pharisees heard that the people murmured such things concerning him, and the Pharisees and the chief priests sent officers to take him.
What verse you at?
32:3
Read in the Holy Name Bible, verse 29. Yeah, we read it. I'm sorry. What verse you at?
33.
Keep reading, please. I don't know where it's skipping.
Joshua unto them, yet a little while am I with you, mm-hmm. and then I go unto him that sent me.
Mm-hmm.
Ye shall seek me and shall not find me.
That's right.
And where I am, thither ye cannot come.
Okay. Yeah.
Will he go into the dispersed among the Gentiles and teach the Gentiles?
See, they think he's going to be going somewhere physically to go teach the Gentiles. They didn't have a clue. They thought the physical guy was going to just go somewhere. As we say, hey, I'll see you later. I'm going to Chicago. And my body gets on a plane and I fly to Chicago and I'm in Chicago walking around. That's how they thinking. They don't know how he meaning going to his Father, which is Yahweh. Keep reading. Mm-hmm.
And where I am, thither you cannot come.
Mm-hmm.
In the last day, that the great day of the feast, Joshua stood and cried, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink.
Mm-hmm.
He that believeth on me, as the scripture has said.
See, fulfilling that drinking of what he talked about, them drinking back here with Moses at that rock, because they cried of thirst. He's wanting to, he's fulfilling that. In that statement, at that time, he's fulfilling that period of time with Moses. And they're drinking the gospel of what he's preaching to them. But they just think it's a cup of water. Keep reading.
And he that drinketh believeth on me, as the scripture has said, yep. Out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water.
Of living water. Read. That is what we're expressing. That is, he's been glorified now, though.
Right.
Now, we read that back there about when he was talking to them about being immersed, about doing the things. But now we have to realize that Holy Spirit that was immersed within the hearts and minds of those Jews first, and then 7 years later to Cornelius and his household, that's still going on. And that still has to be a belief in wanting to escape Egypt. Because, hey, we are not to have to dwell in Egypt, psychologically and spiritually speaking. We're in the fleshly body. We're still remaining on this earth plane, waiting for the universal revelation of Yahshua, the Messiah, is what we're endeavoring to be able to maintain and be in. Give me Ephesians 1 and 22, and I'll be right finished. So this is how this works here. That spiritual fulfillment of what was done in the law and the prophets and how Yahshua fulfilled it by the things he did. He continued to fulfill certain things here in the spiritual fulfillment, but this is for us. Like we're saying, we have to take on that nature or on that spirit and believe on him as we read and hear these stories and how we see how the connection works that gives us the confidence. Ephesians 1 and 22.
And has put all things under his feet.
Mm-hmm. If you can. Actually, just grab 2 and 18. Be fine.
through him, we both have access by one spirit.
Through Yahshua, we have had access unto the Father. That's what the aim was, to help you find and know Yahweh or Elohim as he truly is and actually exists. It used to say to help you find and know Yahweh back in the 1960s.
Right.
Used to say to help you find and know Yahweh as he really is and actually exists.
Right.
And so, but now through Yahshua the Messiah, through this son of learning about the Holy Spirit, not some man on the cross, save his soul, but yet we're learning about Yahweh himself through his son. Keep reading. And we have access to Yahweh. Read.
Now therefore ye are no more strangers and foreigners,
mm-hmm.
but fellow citizens with the sons and of the household of God.
Where is that at? Is it on a physical household on the earth plane, or is it a psychological understanding according to a Holy Spirit on earth, according to spiritual things and spiritual matters, and taking them very seriously and not dibbling and dabbling and touching the things of the earth, because that's as swine, that's as corruptible. That's why we don't want to partake in Christmas and holidays and other such things in order to beguile you away to some such antics as though that really means anything. Keep reading there, please. So you have to be upon the foundation of the apostles because they received it first. And that's what we're building this blood, water, spirit on, because they're the ones who taught it to us.
Right.
Read.
Yahshua, the Messiah himself, being the chief cornerstone.
There's a cornerstone again. Keep reading.
And who,
you know, we say Peter wasn't the cornerstone back there, right?
Yeah.
There's that proof that Peter wasn't the cornerstone, that Yahshua was the chief cornerstone. We mentioned that earlier, right? See how the Spirit will bring things back and hear a little, there a little, stumbling the speech, you know, just as Moses do. And we try to get through it in order to hopefully show the correlations to these things. Keep reading, I'll be finished.
In whom all the buildings fitly framed together.
Fitly, that's us being fit. We're the building, as it were, being fitly joined together in me, in his name. Read.
Grown it up unto a holy temple unto Elohim, in whom ye also have built together for an habitation of Elohim through the Spirit.
And that's where we should abide by, and that's where we ought to habitate at, is in the Spirit of Yahweh Elohim. If you got anything out of tonight's class, all praises to Yahweh Elohim by Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say hallelujah.
Marlon Lev. This will conclude tonight's session. We hold classes here every Tuesday and Thursday from 7:30 to 9:30, and every Sunday from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Let us all stand to be dismissed. I'll be reading the doxology from the last two verses of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say, hallelujah.
Good night, everyone.